Welcome to our Wednesday evening prayer service. My name is Abby, and before we begin, just want to make a quick announcement. I'm on the Women's Day Planning Committee. Our Women's Day is coming up in a couple weeks, May 10th. We're really excited about it. Our theme is Formed, How Women Form Us and the Church in Faith. And we need your help to make a video for that Sunday service. So some instructions are going to be on the screen. We want to hear from women and men, children, teenagers, young and old, short video clips. And as the instructions roll through, you can see they're also on our Facebook, and we'll repost those. But we need to take a video holding your phone horizontally, answering one of the following questions, which are on the screen, in 1 to 2 sentences, so try to keep it short. And then you're going to attach that video to an email and send it to harwell.abby@gmail.com, which is on the screen. And we need those video clips by this upcoming Monday, May 4th, so we have time to edit and pull those clips together and have this larger video to show that Sunday celebrating all the important women in our lives. So we're super excited. We love to hear from you, and please share and encourage people in your household to share as well. Now I'm going to hand it over to Mark and Graham for a prayer service.
Thank you, Abby. We appreciate you sharing with us, and we appreciate you folks. Good afternoon to everyone for joining us. It's a privilege to be able to join you this evening. I'm so thankful that we as a church don't have to stop our mission. We can continue reaching out via the internet and different methods of media, and I just thank God for the opportunity that He has given us just to keep being on the offensive, if you will. So as we begin today, we're going to begin with prayer, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank You, God, for Your goodness, Your grace. I pray, Father, for You leading in this time of worship and praise and reading Your word and prayer. And Father, may we be encouraged, may we be strengthened, may we be spurred on to greater works of love and good deeds in Your name. Father, You have given us this time, and we want to praise You from the bottom of our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to begin by diving into the Word of God, and I ran across Psalm 42 this week in my study, and I was led to, God led me to share this with you today, and I want to read the 42nd Psalm. And I challenge you, as you hear the reading of this Psalm, just put yourselves in the shoes of the psalmist as you listen to these words and meditate on them. I think you'll really be blessed, and this is a very appropriate reading for days that we're finding ourselves in these days. Psalm 42, as the deer pants for streams of water, so I long for You, O God. I thirst for God, the living God. When can I come and stand before Him? Day and night, I have only tears for food, while my enemies continually taunt me, saying, "Where is this God of yours?" My heart is breaking as I remember how it used to be. I, walking among the crowds of worshipers, leading a great procession into the house of God, singing for joy and giving thanks. It was the sound of a great celebration. Why am I discouraged? Why so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise Him again, my Savior and my God. Now I am deeply discouraged, but I will remember Your kindness. From Mount Hermon, the source of the Jordan, from the land of Mount Mizar, I hear the tumult of the raging seas as Your waves and surging tides sweep over me. Through each day, the Lord pours His unfailing love upon me, and through each night, I sing His songs, praying to God who gives me life. O God, my rock, I cry, why have You forsaken me? Why must I wander in darkness, oppressed by all my enemies? Their taunts pierce me like a fatal wound. They scoff, "Where is this God of yours?" Why am I discouraged? Why so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. Today, so much is distracting us, causing us, many of us, to live our lives in fear. This coronavirus has reached South Carolina. What am I going to do? The virus has arrived in Lawrence County. What am I going to do? The stock market is tanking. What am I going to do? Folks, God does not want us to live in fear. Amen. He wants us to live in victory. How do we live in victory? Well, I'm glad you asked. By doing what God tells us to do in His Word. Romans chapter 8, verse 14 and 15 says, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So you should not be like cowering, fearful slaves. You should behave instead like God's very own children, adopted into His family." 2 Timothy, first chapter, verse 7 says, "God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind." God also tells us in 2 Corinthians 10:5, "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ, who is the Word of God." God wants us to take thoughts of doubt captive to His Word. God wants us to take captive thoughts of indulgence. God wants us to take captive thoughts of anger. God wants us to take captive thoughts of fear and make them obedient to Christ. All of us will reach crossroads in our lives. Decisions have to be made. Some can be small and insignificant, while others seem like they can shape the course of our entire lives. How can we know the will of God? How can we correctly choose the path He has set out for us? And what if we make the wrong decision? We spend sleepless nights and days filled with anxiety when we place these burdens upon ourselves. Often we become isolated, feeling completely alone in finding the right answer. Sometimes we're tempted to rush into a decision. Other times we'd rather delay indefinitely. But for those who call Him Father, for those who believe in the power of His name, He provides everything we need to follow His will.
Amen.
He gives us His Word as a compass and an inspiration. Those who live according to the Scripture will always follow in His footsteps. He blesses us with wise counsel through His church and the leaders He has set in place. He hears our every prayer, granting peace and wisdom to those who will only ask. His very Spirit dwells in us, a still small voice that guides us from within our hearts. And in His perfect timing, He will open doors no one can close, and He will close doors no one can open.
Amen.
He will clear the way forward, and no matter the path you choose, you are never alone. He will walk beside you and enfold you with His love from now until the end of eternity. When we put our trust in the Lord, that trust builds faith. That faith builds hope, and that hope builds peace. So trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. May God add His blessings to the reading of His Word. It's great to have my friend and brother in Christ, Graham Burroughs, here sharing what God has put on his heart. And Graham, thank you for joining us. Why don't you share with us just for a few minutes?
Thank you. Good evening to everyone. Blessings to you and your families.
I'd like to read this evening from this is the New American Standard, and I'll be reading also from the Psalms, Psalm 91, the first two verses. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Amen. Even if you're an essential worker, you hear the word shelter a lot. We've been asked to shelter. Even if we have to provide service, we then, after we've provided that service, have to shelter. Shelter can, in an environment that it seems to be full of tension, it can seem like punishment in some cases. It can really seem like incarceration. But the psalmist here gives us a little insight in maybe how to shelter. The psalmist goes on to say that the one who shelters in the Most High will dwell in the shadow of the Almighty.
That's right.
It's always been interesting to me to maybe look at things in a different light. I mean, how can we dwell in the shadow of the Most High? Does God cast a shadow here on the earth? Well, actually, he does. In John 14, the disciples were asking questions of Jesus, and one of those questions by Philip, it wasn't a really question. He asked him a favor. He says, show us the Father. And Jesus rebuked him quite sternly. And then he made this statement, when you have seen me, you have seen the Father.
Amen.
And I don't know whether you have children. If you have children in the house and you've been sheltering in place, you may have tried some finger puppets, shadow puppets on the wall to pass the time. And Jesus was really a shadow of the Father. Jesus said, when you have seen me, you have seen the Father. And just like a shadow puppet on the wall, you don't see a lot of detail, but when you see that shape, you know exactly what it is. You may have tried a bird or something like this, elementary. You know immediately, oh, that's a bird. When we see Jesus, we have seen the Father. And we who have taken shelter in the Father dwell in Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We do that by his shed blood. But in this time, the question is, where are you sheltering? Are you sheltering in your home and treating it like feel like a punishment? Or are we sheltering in Jesus? The psalmist says in 131, he says, surely I have composed and quieted my soul like a weaned child against his mother. My soul is like a weaned child within me. What a beautiful picture of someone or a small child at rest and at peace with his mother. And that's what we can get from dwelling in the shadow of the Most High, being at rest and at peace. He is our peace. He is our hope. I would encourage you to read Psalm 91 this evening in maybe some quiet time. Or if you like music, even if you have access to music, Lauren Daigle has a wonderful song. It's called Look Up, Child. I would encourage you to listen to that also. It's very uplifting in these times. So where are you sheltering? You may be in your home, but are you sheltering in Jesus? Are you sheltering in the Word, in fellowship with Him? I can assure you that is a place of peace and of comfort and hope.
Mark. Thank you, Graham. What a blessing that was. If you've joined us over the last few weeks, you've known we've had specific prayer requests. We've been praying for different groups with different needs that we've thought might be maybe disadvantaged or in special need. And we are praying for a few other groups today, and we want you to join in. Graham is about to lead us in that prayer time. But today we will be praying especially for those in need of regular therapies and treatments that have had to be postponed. Many people are fearful to go to get treatment these days, and with all this going on, let's pray for those that the situation would ease in the next days and weeks, where they do feel more comfortable, where they can go and receive these much needed treatments. Let's pray today also for pastors and church leaders who are faced with current, shall we say, unique circumstances. We're having to rethink, not only during this time, but following this time. What's the normal? What is going to be considered normal in the upcoming years? No one knows. And pray that God would give us a spirit of immediacy for what is needed now, and a spirit of maybe, shall we say, creativity that might be needed in the future. So we'll pray for pastors and church leaders. Let's also pray for missionaries, both those who are here locally, those who are stateside, those who are abroad. Let's pray God's hedge of protection on our missionaries. We're also going to pray today for local, state, and federal government officials and employees. And also, we'll not forget to pray for those who are sick and in need of physical, spiritual, and emotional, as well as financial healing these days. So, Graham, take us to the Lord in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your grace and mercy. Father, thank you for who you are. I'm reminded of the words of Peter, where else can I go? You have the words of life. And Father, you are life. You are eternity. So Father, we thank you for who you are. Thank you that when we are unfaithful, you remain faithful. Thank you, Lord, that you never hold on to a wrong, or your mercies are new. Each morning, every day is a new day, and I thank you for that. So, Father, we praise you and thank you this evening. But Father, we come and ask this evening, Lord, that you would have mercy on those who are in need of therapy, in need of medical therapies. Father, I pray that you would give all those that need an appointment, I pray that you'd give them favor with the hospitals, the doctors, or wherever that therapy is. Father, I pray that you would work schedules out that everyone could receive what they need. And Lord, help us to seek you and to know what is needed and what can maybe just wait a week or however long. But Father, we know that you are in control, so we just pray for favor for working that out. And Father, I also come against any fear that anyone would have in delaying that therapy, even for a day or two.
That's right.
So Father, we ask you to bind the enemy.
Yes.
Lord, you say whatever we bind on earth, you will bind in heaven, and whatever we loose, you will loose. So, Father, we ask you to bind the enemy and loose Lord, loose your blessings, your peace, your comfort on those in need of therapy this evening. Father, for pastoral staff and church leadership, Father, these are unprecedented times. Father, the church is about fellowship, the koinonia. It's about iron sharpening iron. It's about that. It's about the interaction with you and one another. And Father, that has been denied. So, Lord, this is a tremendous burden on pastors and church leadership, Lord, to how to continue this as best as we can. And so, Father, I just pray for pastors and church leaders. You'd give them wisdom and understanding, give them creativity in reaching, Lord, those who you've placed in their care. And Father, this is a new day. We may never go back to normal again. It will certainly be a new normal.
That's right.
So, Father, I pray that you'd give the church leadership insight in how to reach out now and in the future. And Father, I know that there are lots of pastors in smaller churches who are not meeting, who are probably bivocational pastors. They're probably not even working right now, and any income that they would have been deriving from their vocation as a pastor would probably diminish. So Father, I just pray for the financial help to these bivocational pastors. Lord, the majority of the pastors in this country are bivocational. Lord, have mercy. Lord, supply their needs. Father, we do thank you that we are part of the church, and that the gates of hell will not come even close to conquering. It will not prevail.
Amen.
So, Father, even though the church seems a little strange, Lord, thank you for the hope that we will not be overtaken, and we again will meet once again together and enjoy sweet fellowship. Father, for missionaries, Lord, we live in a country where we have an abundance of just about everything. Lord, I want to admit we're spoiled here in the U.S., but Father, the missionaries that you've called, and the missionaries have answered that call to places where there is no medical help, there is very little infrastructure, the food is short. Father, they're going through I can't even imagine some of the experiences that these missionaries are having on the field. So, Father, we ask you to have mercy on them. We pray for protection. We pray for provision. And, Father, we pray for understanding for them. And I pray that you'd fill them with your peace, that they could stand out in a society that has no peace, that does not know you as Lord and Savior. I pray, Lord, that their peace would attract others to them during this time. Father, thank you. Thank you for what you're going to do there. Father, local and state and federal officials, Father, I can't imagine the burden that they are carrying right now. Decisions to be made whether to open up, to remove restrictions on businesses and on state and federal agencies.
Yeah.
Father, balancing economy against lives lost, it is, Father, What a tremendous burden. So, Father, I pray that you'd give our leaders here in Clinton and Lawrence County wisdom and understanding of when to move. Father, at the state level, Father, I thank you for our state leadership, and we pray your blessings on our local and our state leadership, and pray for wisdom for them especially. Lord, they need your wisdom. Yeah. They need, as Mark said, not to lean on their own understanding, but to lean on you in their decisions that they make. Paul, Father, I'm reminded of Paul when he said on many occasions, my conscience is clear before God and men. Yeah. I pray, Lord, that you would so fill our local and state leaders and their decisions that they make. I pray that they would be made with that conviction, that they would have a clear conscience on the decision they have made. Father, at the federal level, Father, we've seen a lot of, I call it animosity or jibes and discord amongst the states with the federal leadership. Father, this should be a time when we should come together for the good of
That's
all.
That's right.
So, Father, I pray for a spirit of unity, Lord, amongst our state leadership.
Yes.
And, Lord, that they would work in conjunction with the federal leadership. And I pray, Lord, that you would revision our federal leaders, that they would have your vision. Lord, I'm reminded of what you said and your model of ministry. I do nothing on my own accord. I only do what I see the Father doing. So, Father, I pray that you'd give that wisdom, that perception, that vision to the federal leaders, to the leaders of this nation, that they would see what you are doing, that they would join with you, and that things would get done where they need to get done. Father, we pray blessings on our leadership. And Father, we pray for those who are sick and in need of healing.
Yes.
Father, we've not been able to have a healing service here recently. Lord, they were sweet times of fellowship. They were times when we could come into your presence. Father, I've seen emotions healed. I've seen spiritual healing. Lord, your hand on people was just amazing. But Father, that's not to be at the moment. So, Father, we pray for those who, as they shelter, would seek you. They would abide in you. They would dwell in you. And they would receive the emotional healing, especially at these times when we're confined together, when nerves are a little jangling. We may be down to our very last one. So, Father, I pray for emotional healing. Father, I pray for physical healing. Some have been confined, and Lord, when we can't get out and if we don't exercise like we did before, we can become physically, Lord, we can become physically just hard to get around. I know myself, without the exercise I was getting, my aches and pains have increased. So we pray for physical healing. But Father, most of all, I pray for spiritual
That's
healing.
Right. Yes.
Father, you have confined a lot of us to our homes. And Lord, we have time to reflect. And Father, there are many who have reflected on the fact that they have no peace, that they are full of fear. So, Father, I pray that you would somehow send your servants to make contact with those who are in fear. Lord, that they would be healed spiritually. Father, that they would know the peace, that they would know that feeling as a weaned child rests with its mother.
Mm.
Father, I just have mercy on those who do not know you as Savior. And Lord, those of us who do, I pray that we would be sensitive and obedient to the Spirit to go and to share when prompted by the Spirit.
Yes, Father.
Father, thank you for this time we can come to you and pray. You know all of our needs before we even ask. But it's about the fellowship with you. Father, thank you for this time. Father, thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your provision for us. And Father, we thank you for the hope that we have in you. And Father, I thank you that even now you are answering our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Graham. You see on the screen behind me the words, "We will not be shaken." And when I ran across this scripture this week, Psalm 21:7, I knew immediately what I was going to title this. Obviously, it's "We will not be shaken." But I want to read this, and then we're going to leave you with a video for you to worship and meditate on. Psalm 21:7 says, "For the king who trusts in the Lord through the unfailing love of the Most High, he will not be shaken." And we're going to play a video now, but I just remembered I forgot to tell you who I am. Many of you know me, but I am Mark McMahon. I'm the worship and music pastor here at First Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us today. God bless you. And now worship and meditate to this video as we leave you. God bless you.
Blessings.
For we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken, we will not be shaken. For we trust in our God, through His unfailing love.